Well, last night was four messages at one. Kind of exploded up here, went in 20 different directions, I guess. So I decided today that it would be a little more focused. But nevertheless, it was a good introduction to a lot of things that I've been thinking, particularly in some of the things that occurred this morning. And I just really enjoy when we connect and we're all seeing things and we're seeing the same thing from different angles. You know, for years of my life, I have come to understand the importance of looking at things from different angles, from different people's experience. Since the theme of this conference is the divine dance, the dance of duality without separation, I put in my notes the spiritual, which is the word ruach, which is interesting. These notes was done in May. I didn't know what you were going to talk about, but it says the word ruach, and this was defined by Rob Bell. It is the ruach is the explosive breath of God that is within you.
Yes.
We know that spirit and breath are the same, and in the ancient Hebrew, we see this complete connection. And I told you last night that we have the dance of contrast, the good and evil, which most of what we think of good and evil has really been based upon a lot of years of how we see good and how we see evil. And when you get into the Hebrew, it's mind-blowing because it doesn't say anything near good and evil. And it actually says good and beautiful.
Yes.
But then welcome to the first step was the, when you're looking at this word, I said it was the dance of contrast, the dance of research. Now we come into this word, which has to do with the dance. It is the Greek word perichoresis. Perichoresis simply means to have a mucho dance and you share identities. This word peri, which means the to surround, to connect, and this is the Greek word we get the English word course. So it's he that leads in the course. When I begin to understand this, the next thing you have to understand is what I call the dance of Tahu and Bahu, and that's in Genesis 1. If you want to, I don't know if anybody has ever looked at the book of Genesis before, but you know, just basically. Book of Genesis 1. And it says, and the earth was formless and void, and darkness was upon the face of the earth, and the Spirit of God was moving. The literal concordant actually says the Spirit of God was vibrating over the surface of the waters. So when you have this word formless and void, and I know Lynn's talked about this, you had the Hebrew word bahu and tahu, which is a completely creative energy that we in our paradigms has either said is creative or chaos. And I know many talks this morning was about how things can be positive or negative. If you really understand the Hebrew language, it is so beautiful because it does not bow to your paradigm of good and evil. It transcends it. And there's a lot of stuff that I tried to find in the Hebrew for years that I could never find. It was a real challenge for me. So the dance of grace, the dance of contrast, the dance of research. Now we're coming to this dance of creativity and chaos. I'll read what I said last night. Everything I knew about science pointed to a different dimension of Hebrew, and everything I knew about Hebrew pointed to a different dimension of science. One of the strongest revelations I ever received was the difference between the soul, the brain, and the mind. Because when I was in charismatic circles, we said they were all the same thing. I remember in 1984, I was at church, and the pastor started preaching, and he said science and spirituality agree. The Bible and spirituality agree. And I actually was quoting a message by Charles Capps called The Pre-Adamite Earth. That is a message he got from Finnis Jennings Day. And he said there was a connection. And so I went out and bought the Dex Bible, and I read about the first half of it in the book of Genesis, and I thought, this reads like a comic book. And so I did not go any further because it was about wars and spiritual warfare and all this, and I thought, I'm confused now. So I didn't continue reading it. I got me a Kenneth Copeland Bible, but I never got rid of mine, and my stepdad picked it up and just started loving it. He said, loved the footnotes. And then years later, I got into Dakes later because I realized that he had so many notes in there that would come from the time period that I study in Hebrew, which is the 18th century Edinburgh, Scotland Hebrews. He apparently had a lot of resources. And I always thought it was weird, though, that from that time point, I just agreed that spirituality and science agree. It is religion and what we have called science that has called a breach, not a repair. And then I remember even Kenneth Copeland back in the 80s did a series called God is Love, God is Light, God is Life. And he would even talk about how there were things in science and light and how it compared to Hebrew. So that was a divine seed in me. And of course, when I was very, very young, I got fascinated with Star Wars. I became obsessive with Star Wars. I ate, drank, breathed Star Wars. And then my grades went down. So my stupid school decided they were going to send me to a psychologist. And after about 6 months, I led that psychologist on a little trip because I would just deny everything they said. And one day I thought, man, I'm missing time outside. So I just said, you know what? And I told her what she wanted to hear, and they dismissed me, and I'm still messed up to this day. But, you know, I just agreed with us. You know, but, so I always was interested in these things. And then in 1988, I met a minister who saw a strong connection between the Aramaic language and quantum physics. And I had never heard anybody preach on quantum physics, and that's kind of his style. And I began to see this connection. In fact, he told me at that time, he said, I believe someday you'll study Aramaic. And all I knew was Greek. I wasn't into Hebrew or Aramaic at the time. And he began to share these things, and I thought, you know, it's interesting, because when I studied Greek, it was all psychological. It was all metaphorical. It's the mind, the will, and the emotions. Yet, people treat Hebrew like it's a dead language. And then when I began to understand quantum physics, years later, I began to read a lot of, like, Dr. Fred Allen Wolf and different things, but I didn't have the Hebrew. See, that's the thing. You can do all you want to with science, but it won't match the Hebrew if you got traditional Baptist Pentecostal Hebrew. The Hebrew you will learn if you go to seminary. That's nice. I didn't say cemetery, like I used to say. But I always just said that word. But when I begin to explore the understanding or understanding of biblical languages, I begin to realize they perfectly sync and line up with what we commonly know of as science. Now, let's go with this. I got a few word studies out of hearing all y'all this morning. Y'all think I shared them all, but I didn't. And I just want to make sure. I'm a huge note taker, and always have been. If I write something down, I remember it, which kind of makes you wonder why sometimes it's like after this, I don't need the notes. You didn't hear that, honey. She's like, oh my God.
I don't believe
you. Well, then I'm clear for another day. We talked about the word homotonal being an archery term, and that is translated as the word sin. Then we have this Greek word harmatia, which we know has the sense of the word offense. And I told you last night we have also the Greek word skandalon, which is many times used as a trigger. But here's the thing. Years ago, when I first came into these things, I thought I could never dance with God because every time I blew it, then there's a huge misstep. The dance was over. I never realized the dance wasn't my dance. It's His dance.
Amen.
It has nothing to do with me. It has to do with covenant. So I come to understand that even though when I miss it, and these are not the words that religion has messed up the most, there's another Greek word that is this word, paratypto, which means, this means to miss the mark, homotono, this means to overstep the mark. And that's the problem of religion, because we're always trying to get God. We think that this body in which God is walking this earth is all about me. And so we think we do our own thing. And I've been trying to do my own thing for years. There's really no such thing except for the fact that I did more of what you would refer to as wrong when I was in religion than I ever did in freedom. Because in 19, it was around 1999, 2000, Carlton Pearson came to Little Rock, Arkansas and taught on these two different Greek words. And at that time, he said, you're never free from sin till you're free to sin. And he said, you have the ability to offend God has been removed from you. Now, we know now God can't be offended, but that just liberated me. Because when I stopped thinking that I could offend God, I quit offending myself. Mm-hmm. Because I had so much in religion. But then what happened is this thing that I had built in my mind, this computer that was all about sin and all about hell, well, it collapsed. And for the next few years of my life, I stayed in this place of just whatever come in the moment. Being in the present moment. And I remember to myself, thinking to myself, I have had a book in my hand since 1984, and it was 99, and I couldn't read. It was the only time in my life that's ever happened. And about 6 months later, this thing rebooted, and I realized, oh my gosh, all this guilt, all this condemnation, all this shame, all of this has nothing to do with God, and has to do with my own heart. And that was such a liberating time. And I'm still enjoying it. I want to say that I learned last night that you couldn't breed a mule. I didn't know any of that. And I'm from Arkansas, so I never knew any of that. Just telling you, I never knew me. So then we come into these Hebrew words that we've mentioned this morning. And I want to expand a little of Habel. And like he said, or Habel. And then you have Ruach, and this word, emits, which is the Hebrew word for truth, or one of the Hebrew words for truth. Now, I left some room here because I want to get into this. And by the way, I have some horrible sermons. You know, sometimes people don't know how to take me because I laugh even at stuff I do. That's a horrible circle. But let's try it. Lynn is the artist of the family. Did you draw a lot growing up, Lynn?
I guess I did.
Okay. I did not. You didn't? I'm just kidding. So, for years of my life, we never had anything about astronomy or astrology in all of my studies. And so this was something I didn't know about. Also, what we call the heart rim, which I didn't know about that either. All I was told, we were to gain heaven and shun hell.
Yep.
That's all we were told. So in all of these years, what happened to me? Well, from me trying not to offend God, I began to close this down. You know, the one way I know if somebody is really free is they're honest. They're honest. You know, I hid for so many years every fault I had because I was afraid I was going to die and go to hell for it. And now, sometimes I'm just honest, not because I'm trying to gain anything, but because there's nothing I can do to gain or not gain it. It's just being real. But I did not know about this dimension, however, yet I claim to know Greek and Hebrew. And if you don't know this, you do not know Greek and Hebrew, because all the Old Testament laws and symbols and all that is based on the zodiac. So when I started looking at this whole dimension here, and I read you some definitions last night, I'm going to actually read you right out of my lexicon. We have this Greek word, aletheia, which is translated as truth. I mean, we would say it straight from the horse's mouth, but that doesn't mean the horse. The Greek word here, aletheia, means truth. This is the Eaton translation. Truth, reality. Truth is the unveiling reality lying at the basis of, agreeing with the parents, the manifested or the verbal essence of matter. In other words, it's the reality that is above matter. That's that word. It's used several times, and it's most of the time translated as truth. However, this word doesn't just come to the point of saying it's truth. It's more of a genuineness that comes to truth. And I put here, the Christos is the truth. All else is transitory. Then you come into this word, which is the word that I put on this end right here, alephes, which my definition of that word is true or the act of concealing. And this is the word that is to mean to hidden or unaware. So this is the hidden treasures in the darkness. How many of y'all know when God first starts dealing with you about truth, the first thing he does is unveil all the lies and the deception and the religion and the belief systems that we've crammed in there. Then you come to this word, which is alethinos. Now, why would that be? Because here is the place of balance. You know, when I started studying truth, the one place I know if somebody's really got the truth is their balance and think they realize they don't have all the truth. A person who really has the whole truth is people who recognize there's more there. Even if they've got a general idea, they understand the fractal, that you can unlimitedly go within the circle, within the circle, within the circle, and only just find more and more and more and more. But when I meet people who put walls up, I know immediately they're having a struggle with truth. Because balance is something that is very, very hard to find in our generation, because it seems like every time we have a movement, people go crazy. You know, I remember when grace was a no-no in charismatic circles. Now grace is everywhere. So what happens? People are now coming out with this grace message, and when people get a hold of stuff that isn't by revelation, they become dangerous to themselves. Now, they're not dangerous to me, but they're dangerous to themselves. Then we talked about this term here, and when we looked at this word Hebel and Ruach, I told you that it connected to this word. This is right out of my lexicon too. Mantaos. It's translated as vanity. The Greek word mutios comes from the word matin, which means devoid of force or truth. Now, for years of my life, scholars, and this is, I'm talking what I call semantic range scholars, in other words, more modern translators, some of them translate that as an illusion. I have struggled with the term illusion simply because, in a philosophical level, it is an illusion. But everything's energy. So, more of a better word would be transitory. We are seeing the lower breath, the higher breath, the kenos, which I'm going to get into, these different levels, is all about breath. It's all about energy. We're looking at the same thing over and over, And what I'm coming to understand is the more I understand everything is energy, the more balanced I become, and the more balanced I become, the more I come to real truth. The problem is, in my opinion, is not truth. The two things we struggle with the most, or let me say this, I struggle with, is law and time. Because here is where our timetable gets messed up, because I don't live by psychological time. For instance, I was driving a while ago, and I'm in Dallas speed, and I'm following people in Dalton speed. I mean, I know my car and our car was two different things. But was that a real time? No, it was psychological. And I said, I'm going to get a ticket if I don't slow down. So, and it's not that I have a hot rod. I'm just eager, I don't know. But anyway. Montanus, by William Sunday, which wrote a tremendous thing in the book of Romans, and then also translated in the Waylon Trend, was condemned to have its energies marred and frustrated. And this is one of the translations you'll hear with this word, is frustrated. Well, I can agree with that, because for years of my life, even though I sat in religion and I heard the same old stuff over and over, I was frustrated, even though I didn't even know why I was frustrated. In fact, I remember sitting in the middle of circles knowing that I ain't got the truth. And I was mad because I didn't have it, even though I didn't have a clue what it was. Somebody said, amen to that.
Amen. Yep.
Oh, I remember being frustrated. And then somebody said, well, just give it to Jesus. What's that mean? The Greek word there is translated devoid of force, truth, it says, rootless, fruitless vanity. It's used in the book of Proverbs when the book of Proverbs says there's a way that seemeth right unto the man, but the end thereof death. The English word illusion, if it's used in its proper text, is a right term because it means that which you have believed in, a mirage, a illusionary thing that is by itself decaying and you come to realize. Now, that's a whole different word than what the Sanskrit word is, which is Maya. And Maya doesn't have anything to do with illusion. It has to do with you empowering a perception of energy. You're creating a world that is basically, in and of itself, your own creation. And sometimes we don't like what we create. I know I don't. Sometimes I've created some stuff that, boy, let me go blame God for that one. Well, I'm going to tell you, me and the devil, and some of y'all that know me, I went around with that one. Because for years of my life, you know, they told me my ministry was spiritual warfare, which meant I had to be an expert on the devil. And that meant I studied the devil, talked about the devil. That was the only thing that I inherited that actually from my family. My uncle used to read books on demonology and smoke pot. My aunt, which just transitioned, would tell me, I got to talk to you about knowing who you are in Christ, and give me a book on the cult. And half the book was on the cult. And I said, I do not want to be an occult technician. Then we have this word here, kinos, which we think means to empty, but it actually means to transfer. Now, in the Hebrew, remember I told you this word's in met right here, that's balance. Then when you come to here, this whole thing is what we call the Hebrew word, amen. Now, this does not make a whole lot of sense so you start filling in the ideas of time, because here is where our struggle with time begins. But I want to throw a little nugget out to you first. Go with me to Genesis chapter 2. Some of y'all may have to use your index to find it, the book of Genesis. Your Bible, really doesn't fall open, it just stays there. Genesis 2, 7. Then the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. Now, I have something to throw at you, and I actually talked to Lynn before I threw it at him. I said, I'm gonna throw this at him, and I wanted to get what he thought first. Because that has a lot to do. This is all Amy's notes. I'm gonna have her here. Okay. Now, I'm going to relate to you what, when you look this up on the internet, this word breath in Genesis, now this is your strong drawing, I'm going to straighten it up here in a minute and get the Western mind out of it, is neshama, which comes from a word that says nasham, which means to creatively create or destroy, and it means to blow away. It is not ruach in Genesis 2. In Genesis 1 and 2. But when you get into other verses, ruach is in there. In fact, I'm going to be honest with you, half of the text, here is a more accurate translation. I got it from Jeff Benner. This is actually his book. I borrowed it and then gave it back to you. It says, this is Jeff Benner's translation, and Yahweh, the powers, pressed out of Adam the multitude from Hadamah, and it blew into the nostrils, Nepesh Mat. This is how his wording is, and I thought this was interesting, the way he worded this. Nepesh, not Nepesh, in other words, Nemesh Nesh Mat. Well, if you know anything about this word, that's Egyptian for the Egyptian scales of justice. But this word has more to do with the totality of Elohim, Eha'aha, puts its active and kinetic energy as being the first cause, and it breathed into creation, and that created the what is known as the living soul, which is Nenefresh, or Nepesh Chaya. Now, why is that interesting? Because what we have missed in this word right here is that it is a creative breath, because when God's breath comes out, it's not creative or destructive, it's both. Because it's not connected to time. See, here's where the problem comes with time or timelessness, is that we still try to put God in a box, call it good and evil, and call it time. But when you understand fractals, fractals is you understanding there is a dimension of a pattern within a pattern. Well, he breathed in him the nasmat. He breathed in him that, and that opened up both a creative and a destruction, and the adamah, so it can release the ruach, because the ruach is pure. That's pure spirit. Now, we have said for years, or I have, there's a difference in creation and formation. Well, when you talk about the Ruach, you're talking about creation, or that which is being lowered into a lower density of matter. But when you're talking about this word, it's formation. Now, if I say that to you in English, it doesn't click. But if you understand the difference in creation and formation, in the Hebrew and the Greek, it is a beautiful, beautiful picture, because creation is layers. That's the reason I get so excited about these dimensions, because the creativity is all based on this word, bara. And here's the issue. Most people have interpreted that, and I think you said it, to create something out of nothing. But the something that came out of nothing came out of the being of God.
Yeah.
So, where is really creation the issue of what we think of creation as an act? If God didn't have a voice and he animated, then what the issue is we're trying to figure out when God spoke, not what did he speak. And I think that's the error of the church. I don't care how many books you read on theology, they're more interested in when it happened than what broke through. Do you get what I'm saying? Hundreds of books have been written about if Jesus was born at a certain time. Hundreds of books. when it happened, not what happened, or what broke through. So our theology of creation and formation has been limited to what we think of spirit and matter, and if we don't know what spirit and matter is, and the soul is the most confusing subject in the church. I mean, I have read books on the soul, and you name, for every one view, there's 100 views. Nobody even directly quotes each other. They used to tell me, Mark, the soul is the mind, the will, and emotions. Well, that made a whole lot of sense until I started experiencing God, and then it didn't make no sense. Because we've tried to take the soul and put it into a box. Now, when I start going into these words,
John Wesley to the front desk.
John Wesley's here? Some of you Methodist hey. Brothers are going to be shouting here in a second. So, when I study Greek, and I've done this with this word, you have a word that's called kairos, which means the now moment, and you have the word chronos. I read the book years ago by James Barr, and he said when these two words are used separately, they have distinct meanings. When they're used together as a cluster, then they have the same meaning. May I submit to you that that's the same way with these Greek words. These Greek words have their own distinguished meaning, but when they're used in context together, they have the same meaning, because we're not trying to say, is God good or is God bad? We're saying he's everything. And this is the problem of duality, is we can't handle paradox, we can't handle conundrums, so we're always trying to patent stuff down into a belief system. People, Mark, you Trinitarian or oneness? Yes and no. People ask me, Mark, you finished work? Yes and no. Want to know about atonement? Did you know the Wycliffe translators looked into the Hebrew word translated in your Bible as the Hebrew word for atonement, looked at that word and said, there is no way to translate the depth of that into an English word, and they created the word atonement. And whole theology has been built on atonement. Oh, it means to cover, it means to remove. None of that is correct. It's something some translator put in there because he couldn't handle the real Hebrew, because he couldn't put in 15 words what that word meant. But yet we have some of the craziest doctrines ever created called penal substitution. And I've studied atonement. People say, which view of you are? Which ones do you know about? Because there's a whole bunch of them besides Calvin and Augustine. Because in certain circles, that's the only people they think exist. Well, there's Calvin, there's Augustine. They say, what about Mark Eaton? Because the atonement is this whole corrosion of concepts for years and years and years, in which they put into a box that was all based on one another. And if you go back into the ancient world, you'll find no evidence of half of these words. In fact, do you remember when Paul said, in my weaknesses, my grace is sufficient? The Hebrew word that was translated as atonement actually is the word for pitch. It means to pitch. As in Noah pitched a tent. Was that about a physical ark? Was it about a boat that sunk? Looked like Popeye's boat when he's in the cartoon? Or was it Noah pitched a tent of grace? Because in 2 Corinthians, when he said, my grace is sufficient, read it in the Amplified, my grace will pitch a grace tent over you. The idea of pitch is the same one used in the Song of Solomon for to die, like you dye a shirt. It's not this or that, it's one. I've been spending all my life preaching a message that I got out of Patch Adams when he was supposed to be in a mental institution. The guy kept telling me, how many fingers am I holding up? How many fingers am I holding up? And at the very end, he said, one. He goes, you got it. And I went back and watched that movie, and I went, oh my gosh, I got it. There's not two, there's one. Well, I had a whole lot of help. It wasn't the movie. I got that after. I watched it several times before I got there. Robin Williams did play in some interesting movies. Makes you kind of wonder about stuff. So when I look at these words for creation, when I look at these words for time, this is the word for present moment. This is chronos, and I've told you this Me and time's chronos is not psychological time. It's not the clock there. It's not this clock here. It's the path of the zodiac. And when you come into this, you understand that this whole thing is the cosmos, which we grossly mistranslated as world. That's not the world. That's cosmos. That's cosmology. And then you have this whole thing, which is an age. An age is from this age to this age, which is Aeonian, the only word you are people understand. And then when you look at time, you understand what I said last night, that you have kenos, which means new in quality or new in nature. And then you have this word, which is nuos, which means new in respect to time. So the new creation is not new because God decided to come up with plan B. New is in the sense that God always had the same thing, the same plan. God never had a second plan. It was always his plan. It was never wrong. It was never flawless. He never failed.
Amen. Yeah.
He never got pissed off in Genesis 6.
Amen.
He didn't go and send Jesus because he was trying to get a bailout. He wasn't paying off the devil, which is half the idea of the substitution and atonement. And I go into theology, and I studied this stuff years ago, but I'd studied linguistics, and I'm going, what a lot of crap. A whole lot worse than that. But anyway, so then when you look at these words, you understand that Catholicism did not say you a belief system that is not connected to a whole bunch of belief systems, and they have brainwashed us into an understanding and a thinking that is so crazy. But yet when person comes out of hell, what do? I have met people that were so on fire that God wasn't sending them to an eternal hell, only to find them create another box and crawl back in it. And it blows my mind. And I don't want to bring up the one that was a struggle for me, and that was law. I mean, law was a negative thing for me for a lot of years. Well, in my personal opinion, Hebrew has three dimensions. And listen, when we've been talking in this conference, I love it that you guys can think dimensionally. Because I deal with people all across the body of Christ that when I say think dimensionally, they have no idea what I'm talking about because their belief system says there's only one dimension. And that's me, myself, and I. They think the only thing that's going to go on in heaven is going to be an amplification of what they experience in their church. And they don't understand how to think dimensionally. And I'm going to be honest with you, I didn't until I started studying ancient Hebrew. And one day I realized the contrast is not good and evil, and never has been good and evil. In fact, that is not what the Bible says. But we have to understand that most of what we have known of as evil has been the work of more philosophy than it has been in theology. We go into circles and they say, we're going to teach you Greek and Hebrew. You know what? They're taught word studies. And they memorize whatever they got to do to pass. And they're on to their next degree. And they have no idea. And then they go this degree. I know a guy, one was telling me, he got a degree at Southwestern Seminary. I've been to their library. He got Southwestern, went to SMU, went to Dallas Theological. He went to Baylor. I don't know what's special about Baylor, and decided to enroll Hebrew and Aramaic, and they laughed him out of the class and said, you've been reading all about his books. You better get in there and find out what it says for yourself. Well, we're not told that in languages. We're told this is what we got to believe. And so when I started studying this thing for myself, and you know, in the beginning, it was to prove a certain belief system. I ain't going to lie to you. But the further I got in there, I couldn't find half of the stuff I've been taught as a child. And I'm looking in there on some of this stuff they call atonement, and I'm sitting there going, this does not make a lick of sense. But I've been so brainwashed, well, you don't want to mess with that one. Oh, you don't want to mess with that? You know, original sin, you can mess with Adam and Eve. And yet, when I got into studying this, I realized that I had spent my life trying to make this book fit. And it will not fit. I don't care what you do, I don't care how much you change it, until you see it for what it is, and then it is the most beautifully designed thing. You'll spend up half your night looking into it, and you're not trying to prove anything.
Amen.
You're not trying to, it's effortless. And guess what? You'll get help. Somebody will send you the just as crazy as you are material, and you'll go, oh my gosh. And for most of you in this room, I know some people get their feathers ruffled. I understand that. By the way, I would translate the Hebrew word there for Genesis 2 as he imparted into him the breath of life, which created balance. Not balance as in good and evil, but balance as in the breath of God will bring you into a dance. Because for years of our life, we've been trying to get rid of the ego. We've been trying to get rid of flesh. We've been trying to get rid of the devil. We've been trying to get rid of all this. And the more we try to get rid of, the worse it got. And I can tell you, I spent my life in a complete, absolute, I think somebody used the term adversary. To wake up and realize that I have spent my life chasing something that absolutely, positively was my own creation, and then to realize none of it was bad. None of it was negative in the sense that we call negative, because every bit of it turned as a stepping stone. I look back at my life now and I'm thinking, you know what you were doing? But at the time I said, okay, don't you just leave me in the backside of the desert to leave me. And I had a lot of time in prayer. You know what that meant? I was informing God of what he didn't know. I spent 8 hours a day. I spent 7 getting rid of shame and guilt, and another hour trying to figure out who this person I was talking to who didn't know about half what I was talking about. You know, I straightened him out, and he just did not listen. That's the problem. So when we begin to realize these things, we begin to understand that half of what we have been looking at is a construct. Now I'm going to share this, and then I want to move on to something, move on to another person. In Hebrew, you have 3 dimensions. You have numbers, you have colors, you also have images. However, in Greek, you have 1 dimension. But yet, the Greek always was used to release the image of the Hebrew root. We turned the Hebrew symbolism into a language, and we turned it into a language of nouns, not verbs. Because Hebrew is always creative. It's always moving. And we've created in something, oh, there it is. There's an object I'm going to study. No, in Hebrew, the object is always moving. Because it's you. It's not something else. It's you. So when I started looking at this, I was reading a book, and I have it with me, a book called Waters of Creativity, that's looking at the numerology of the number 11 and what is called Bible acrostics. Now, Bible acrostics is where you look at Psalm 119, and it tells you that there's a Hebrew alphabet. Now, here's the problem with our translators. Now, I went back and looked at this. If our translators was as ignorant to remove the Hebrew alphabet from that Psalms 119 translation, that tells me how dumbed down they are. Well, I looked at translations, and I was amazed that no one said it's an acrostic poetry. It's Middle Eastern poetry, which we don't understand because we think poetry is just being beautiful and colorful. But one of the biggest things in Hebrew is called parallelism, where you take 2 things, say it 2 different ways, but you mean the same thing. That, my friend, is a fractal. So when we read the book of Proverbs, we're trying to get a literal meaning out of it, and it's using 2 different metaphors to say the same thing. So when you read these translations, for instance, the Fenton translation says the word stanza. Why would you take the Hebrew alphabet and put the word stanza? You go to your Amplified Bible, have the Hebrew. I have my dates with me. I'll show you my dates. It's where I've been. But my dates has the Hebrew alphabet, but never mentions an acrostic poem. And I said, if translations see something, this Bible, and are covering it up, there has to be a reason. Because half your Psalms are to be acrostic Psalms. They didn't have the Hebrew alphabet.
I think Bullinger said that.
Yeah, Bullinger's notes said that. You got Lamentations 3. Then the thing that really blows your mind is somebody asked me, okay, Mark, look up acrostics. I say, I got news for you. The whole Hebrew language is acrostic because you drop the vowels, and it's all symbols. Now, this is an amazing thing to a person who's been looking at this is the fact that it's DNA, because in chemistry and biology, when things become out of sequence, what happens? It becomes harmful or dangerous. Well, then I read a guy by the name of Ronald Murphy. He's Catholic. They led him into the Vatican to do all these studies, and he came out and he admits that he's an expert on wisdom literature, and he says there are many verses in the Bible that should have been written with the Hebrew alphabet, and they changed the sequence to the Hebrew words. So if they took the alphabet out of the deal, guess what? They changed the sequence. But the whole thing is a story. So he asked me, Mark, is this man-made or is this God? I said yes and no. Because if you really knew God, you would know what the Hebrew alphabet, and you know when it's out of sequence. But how many of you know, the Bible tells us the story of what we've done to ourselves. Isn't that neat? Isn't it neat in the book of Genesis that when he fought with the angel, or whatever he's supposed to, that Jacob said it, the thigh here was broken. We read that, and then it says under there, no one eat the thigh of an animal. You know, that's when, you know, that was inspired to write. You know why? They knew religion would take something that was God and turn it into some sort of religion and worship it. Look at the brazen serpent. They didn't know what that was, and they turned around and worshiped it later, and it's Nehushtan. It's a piece of rats. Well, it's the same way today. We are reading stuff that has not got to do with something dead, something that's back there. It's a living, organic thing, and we've turned it into idolatry. And we call it church. And the more that I study, the more that I search, the more that I find these things, the more determined that I've only scratched the surface. Yeah, that there is so much more here. And if you're going to translate it, you're going to talk about 13 different words to translate this. The word good in Greek should have been translated harmonics. It should have never been translated as good. Eden Bekingan said, and this is an Amplified Bible too, that the spirit of truth or the spirit of reality. I never knew why the translators differed in that until today. Because the word truth in English, if you study etymology, means faithful, covenant, loyalty. That sounds like hesed in Hebrew. But the word reality changed meanings in the 17th and 18th century to mean sincere. So our translator said the spirit of reality or the spirit of sincerity. So we thought reality is sincerity. No, reality is the reality of real oneness, and there's only one reality. In fact, I got news for you, there's only one love. Well, Brother Mark, ain't there supposed to be like all these other Greek words? Well, okay, you got one love, hesed, okay, that's one love, but in Greek, you have all these different words. Well, those different Greek words isn't a new kind of love. It's to build down and express the love that it is. And I got to tell you, there are texts in which Jesus, it actually says that phileo, which we think is brotherly love, meant to kiss. And what in Proverbs was the woman seduce him with? Her feet. What did that woman kiss? His feet. Do you know in the Jewish Talmud, that's the place of a rabbi? That's why they were mad. Wasn't because she was just going and kissing on his feet. You know, that'd be really different. But it was because she put herself in the position of a rabbi. That same Jewish Talmud said it would be better for a woman to man to be castrated than to be a woman. Now this is what our rabbis wrote years and years and put a time stamp on all this stuff. I tell you, when I spent years trying to get out of Greek thought, I thought I'd go into Jewish thought. That's as big a bondage as there is. Then you go to the ancients, and you're watching the History Channel. I said, what in the world is all this stuff? Then you're looking up Nephilim and all that stuff. I have a friend of mine told me, this was funny about the book of Ecclesiastes, he's Hebrew roots, and he told me, he said, one of these days, y'all quit getting depressed and read the book of Ecclesiastes. It's the most positive book you ever read in your life. He said, but you got to read it in Hebrew. He's kind of a different fella. He told me the other day, I was ministering, and I thought I really laid it down. And he come over, and he slammed his fist down. He goes, when you come quit going through the back door and go through the front door, go through Hebrew. That's what he said. He's an interesting guy. was with a charismatic, he's actually a fighter plane. He flew airplanes. Grew up in Kentucky, saw an airplane go, and went right over his head and sonic boom. He said, that's what I want to grow up and do. And he became a fighter pilot, was flying into a island, and he heard such and such ruler is there, open fire and kill them all. And about the time he went to hit the button, his spirit said, no, don't do it. And he withdrew. And he said, from that day forward, I'll be a trainer and I'll fly airplanes, but I'll not do combat. Guess what? The guy was not even there. The military told him to do it. So he left, and a few years later, they offered him. And he was a. Chris and John Wesley. So the thing that the Baptist, he was a Baptist, they told him, you can go to Israel and study with Rick Joyner and Paul Kane and all these guys. And what it was, they needed him to be the third one, the fifth, I think the 50th one, so they could do the tour. So he goes over there, and the guy that's doing the camels and tending the tour guide, he said, look, you can go with them or you can go with me. And he rode camels, and the guy told him Aramaic and Hebrew. Blew his mind, because they don't read the Bible the way we do. They read it by Jewish interpretation, which is, first of all, surface reading. That's most of your leading denominations, is surface reading. Then the next one is hinting. You got a few people that would hint to a few things. And then the next one, what's the next one? Allegory. Well, that's a no-no. You can't look at allegory. You know, even the word allegory is Greek. And then when you get into the other, that is the full mystical truth in which you cannot put into a box. And there are scholars, Rabbi said, for every Hebrew word, there are 70 interpretations. You know that is because they think dimensionally. Because it takes 70 English words to say what we're trying to say, because we're up here trying to tell you what the soul means in Greek and Hebrew and Egyptian and Sanskrit and all this. And we're trying to tell you, and we can't find an English word that makes it fit. And now we're finding that science is doing the same thing. People ask me, are you creation or evolutionist? Yes and no. Because I think, just be honest, I think we've destroyed and created this planet several times. But it's just matter. If we're into a marriage of spirit and matter, how come we always try to eliminate the one or be the other? Why is a marriage, if it's a dance, why do we keep trying to eliminate one?
Amen.
I remember years ago, I did everything I could to get rid of my flesh, crucify, get rid of it, fast. None of it worked. I tried to get rid of the devil. And I'll be honest with you, the only thing that ever happened is I'm sitting in the middle of a meeting, and God said, hey, you know what the word devil means? It's live spelled backwards. And he explained the Bible in one sentence, and I have thought about this the rest of my life. This Bible is really nothing but cycles of time and cycles of dimensions, and it does not matter if you get in time, this could be the most destructive book you've ever read. But you get outside of time, you realize everything is cycling and circling and fractaling, and it's all a dance. Yeah. And that even the part that is absolute reality. I remember when I first started listening to Lynn, I said, how can nothing be intimate? I remember I was throwing my notes around because I was in my trash truck listening to CDs. I said, like, how can something be intimate and be a nothingness? I'm just crumpling. But you know what? It has to be intimate if I'm driving around 12 hours a day thinking about it. You get consumed because of what it is. I was zeroing in on what I considered contradictions. And next thing, I was hooked. And I was at the library. And I thought, well, I got to do Hebrew. But I live in a Jewish community, and there's 15 different kinds of Hebrew there. See, it's one thing to be doing Hebrew and you're in Arkansas, because you can just have your own little thing, because most people don't know Hebrew. You can just order your books and wait for them to come in the mail. But where I live, I can go down the road, and I never forget, I went in there and met one of them Jewish guys, and I said, hey, how many trees there are? He goes, well, we got to look it up with the rabbi said. So I went to the next one. He goes, there's only one tree, and there never has been none. And I thought, well, I like this guy. And then I found out later that he is a Messianic, Jewish, Hebrew, Jew, who don't believe in the historical Jesus. Okay. That was a little mind blowing back in those days. So then I was like, oh, you're a what? You know, he told me, oh yeah, that's it. There was all the books in the library, there was no English in any of them. And so I thought, well, I'm gonna leave Hebrew alone for a while. That's what I said, because there's just mass confusion. But then, you know, now I'm finding that Hebrew roots had exploded years ago in the Dallas metroplex, and all those guys went underground. I mean, that's where the real Indiana Jones is at, and he brought hundreds of Gnostic and Kabbalah documents into the state, into Arlington, Texas. His name was Vendell Jones. That's the real Indiana Jones. And yes, he was really looking for the Ark. But he was also pretty radical. And he was teaching Hebrew to all these people who was trapped in this bondage, trapped in this traditional thing we call church living. And they had Dr. Roy Blizzard was at CFNI. I mean, Hebrew exploded in Dallas, and then it just went away. And here I'm sitting there thinking, I'm going to teach these people something. And man, they're coming out of the woodwork. They're scaring the fire out of me what they're doing. Well, wait a minute. And to find that that remnant has always been there. Listen, we're not calling forth anything new. We're only bringing to light what already is. Yes. And that's who you are. Yes. You can call it creation, evolution, reformation. All we're doing is bringing to light the people that have been here all along, and it's coming out of the woodworks. And Lynn's mounting up, so he's ready to go. I really, and this is the amazing thing, is that when I found these CDs, I thought, man, this guy, Lynn Haynes, is crazy. I said, man, ain't nobody thinks like that. And I started looking up stuff and documenting. I couldn't find half of it. And then all of a sudden, the next thing you know, I wake up one day and go, oh my gosh, where has he been? Where have I been? Now they're looking for Jim. It's Chris, John Wesley. They're going to look for Augustine. Now listen, all I can say is, Lynn come, because I want to hear his thoughts and what is. I know he's got something burning. He always prepares extra for his conferences, so we want to for sure hear every bit of that, not miss a bit of it. I'm an hors d'oeuvre to the steak, but I am so excited. Because even when I talk to some of you, you do not realize the nugget, the morsel of nugget that you have to offer, because you think, oh, I'm just so intimidated. Man, if you just share what your truth is, you do not realize. There's stuff that I just, in casual conversation, I'm going, did you hear that? That fit. I got emails all about fractals from John, and I'm sitting there going, oh my gosh, this is what I've been working on in my lexicon, because I'm dealing with the creation words in Greek and Hebrew right now in my lexicon. And I'm going to throw every book I had out the window because I'm so frustrated. Do you realize that my frustration is a God frustration? And even though it's frustrating, I love it.
Yeah.
I love it. I love this frustration. I love it. I dance with my darkness. I dance with my chaos. I don't dance with my karma. I don't dance with legalistic law, but I dance with my own sense of what I call my struggles. Because when I see the thing in me, you know, years ago my spiritual father came to me one day and he said, we were all praying, oh Lord, let it rain, rain the revival. He said, oh Lord, clean up the mud. I said, what? He said, the first thing all that dirt's going to have is mud. And he taught me, if they say anything and it rises something up in you, that something has to go.
Yep.
And I remember being in front of them people, and man, I was giving them Greek and Hebrew. I was slapping them elders and pastors upside the head. I'm giving everything I got. And he's standing there just like this. And I said, what are you doing? He said, I'm dying. That's what you're supposed to be doing. And that pastor got up one Sunday morning and he directly quoted three of my friends. And I got out the door and he said, what did you hear? I said, the only right I have is the right God gave me. And if he doesn't give me the right to speak, I don't have the right to speak. God couldn't even speak to him. He was animated. I said, what did you see? And he said, I went up there and yanked that pulpit and let him have it. And I asked my friend Ronnie, he said, what I've done? He said, I was dying because it was proving how much still in me. So even our accusations, our slanders, the things. Don't burn bridges. I said that last night. For the very people that give you the hardest time may be your door ministry. Those people who come to me, I had a pastor come to me, he said, Mark, if you don't get in that Greek and Hebrew and stop prophesying at the drop of the hat, he said, I'm gonna sit you down. He created a monster. Now he's like, oh, back up the Greek and Hebrew. I said, too late now. But you know, we can sit down and have a discussion, and he'll mess with me. And sometimes I think, honestly, he had some help. I think God erased some of his memory. We had an argument that almost destroyed the church over what soulishness was, but Watchman Nee, he came up and said, you ever read Watchman Nee? I said, is this a trick question? I don't think you remember that. God will wipe the very people who accuse you, because they don't know, they're frustrated just like you are. So I'm telling you, man, y'all get ready, because I know y'all had some opposition here. And I thank God for the labor. I thank God for the fact that y'all have hit this thing every single day. That these great truths that you hear about in conferences is done every single Sunday, Monday. This ain't something that happens every once in a while. It's a 24-hour thing.
Yes.
And something cancels, you got more time to study. So, hey. But I'm in Dallas, Texas. I'm in the Baptist capital of the world. I was at Panda a while ago, and I thought, boy, these people got some strange, and everybody's staring at Donovan. Oh, yeah. I forgot about this little guy. The Chinese people say, I know him. Oh, yeah.
How many of you understand what fractal is? Any of us? John, can you give me a real, real simple
definition? No, I don't even know what a fractal is.
Not sure. Okay. Mark's idea was the layers of an onion.
The more you peel it back.
I think that's a good simple way of trying to break it down. So, yes?
I have what I think is a very simple way. It's a little crude, but for all of you who have iPhones and you take a picture and then you go take your picture, and then it gives you the option by spreading out all the same image in several different little interpretations or colors, that's like a fractal.
Yep.
It's the same thing. Mm-hmm. Just a little different, but still the same thing.
How many of y'all have seen on the internet Fibonacci sequence, and then they focus down in on one little aspect of the Fibonacci, anywhere on it, focus in on it, the more they draw into it, the whole thing is there again. And the deeper you go, it's there again. And the deeper you go, it's there again. Well, the thing that occurred to me, and this occurred to me just years ago, just studying Hebrew, was that that's how the Bible starts out, as a fractal book, as it begins to look at something, and then it takes that particular thing that it's looking at, and it shows it again, and again, and again, and again, and again, and stays with that. So again, I will use that idea, that definition, if you've ever seen the Fibonacci sequence where that you take a microscope and just focus in deeper and deeper into it, and then all of a sudden you see the same image, deeper and deeper into it, same, it just continually does that. And so when I began to see that in Scripture, it dawned on my lightning fast mind, oh, okay, that's what this means, that's what this means. It wasn't trying to talk to me about historical people who lived extremely long periods of time, or it wasn't trying to talk to me about normal, average-sized women having sex with a huge, giant angel and then producing his offspring, that my mind says, that can't be done. Because it will rip her apart to grow that embryo in her womb, let alone, even if she has C-section, if she carries it full term, what's she going to have? And so we lack the ability to think commonly. And the reason that we do lack that ability is I'm going to go back to some words that I talked about that we aren't familiar with, that we do need to get familiar with, menticide. And I tell you, this word was actually introduced to the neurological, psychological community from a Dr. David Brown. Menticide. It's the same thing that we do with pesticide. We intentionally spray this stuff around our plants or whatever for a purpose. We have been menticide. Religion has done this to us, and we have been brainwashed. We have had different things done to us psychologically so that we think in a psychological pattern, and if somebody says something that's contrary to that, it throws me off balance, and usually anger will pop up, or I don't agree with that, or that's I don't believe that. And we get caught in that mentality rather than if we would be as a child and be open and open ourselves up to a possibility that maybe I haven't thought that before. Maybe that's outside my paradigm. Maybe I can embrace that and that might help me in my journey. And so my suggestion is that we can all use a little help in the journey. Yes, I think we can. I know I can, and I'm constantly looking at that. So I want to talk about a fractal that is constantly approached over and over and over in Scripture. I want to use it from two different avenues. And I birthed the stick man 20-something years ago from a teaching I did out of the book of Revelation on the seven churches, relating to seven churches, not as the institutions that we know of as the churches, and not as myself as the churches, but a divine happening within my being that was exploded into the commandment of words that were coming up out of me. And that's what the church was. When you really go and you study ekkleo or ekklesia, you begin to realize it's not talking about an institution with a steeple on the roof or stained glass windows. It's not talking about me necessarily individually, even though it is, but it's talking about something that's birthing inside me that gives me the command of kleo words. And those words have creative purpose. And if I can understand that and I begin to see that, that's what happened for me, and that's how I birthed the stick man with that mode or that mentality, the seven churches. However, that has been for me a fractal because I start seeing it everywhere. I saw it in the seven rainbows. I saw it in the seven golden candlestick that actually has 22 knobs, that actually is the number that creates an embryo, that creates you. So you are birthed with the 22 letters that are the creative energy of God inside your very being. And they've always known that. The ancients knew that. The ancient wisdom always talked about that. It didn't matter if you went to Sumerian tablets or cuneiform tablets. It didn't matter. They had this wisdom. They knew this wisdom. And the Hebrews, I'm not even really sure they were Hebrews, but whoever the Kabbalists or whoever these were that come up with the 22 Hebrew glyphs, which were, They were glyphs, holy characters that were displaying the facets of energy or the facets of the sun as it moves in its journey, as it moves in this journey in the sky. Okay, so that they don't really know who come up with these, with the Hebrew glyphs. Well, it was made into an alphabet, which was a dumbing down of it. And a lot of people don't know that. I had this lady who was on my, she passed, she graduated last year. She was in her 80s, and she was a Hebrew professor in New York. And so she got on my monthly CD. This has been several years back. And she would call me, and she spoke real proper, and you just butcher that language, da-da-da. Then she said, but don't stop doing it. Just keep doing it. I don't know where you get that. It's just so good. She would chew me out, but then she would encourage me and say, I don't know where you get all that, but it's good. I said, well, I dropped the vowels. That's basically all I do. I mean, that's not really basically all I do. I just take a word like Mark had on here, neshama. I'll take a Hebrew word, breath, neshama, and I'll drop the vowels. out of that particular word, and then I begin to look at the characters, the Hebrew characters, to see how they have been compiled or put together to form a word, like yod heh vav heh. See, I'll take those and I drop, you know, they've done so much, they put vowel points in different places, change different things, and they come up with Jehovah, they come up with Yahweh, they come up with other ways to take this Hebrew glyph to try to build a religious ideology. You know what we brought into? We bought into their religious ideology, then we become a servant of that ideology that we're in that box. And we don't know how to get out of that box. And I come up and I say, Jehovah is a tyrant, and they get mad at me and want to throw stones. And I say, no, I'm sorry. I meant really Jehovah is a picture of your physical body that's made up of hydrogen, nitrogen, and oxygen with the base element of carbon. Yes. And I said, it's a physical structure. It's you. You're the tyrant. Yes. Wow. Because you are Jehovah. And you didn't realize that. You thought it was some guy back there. And it's not. And it never was intended to be. So, and I realize that's so difficult for us to swallow as a pill because of again, menticide. And menticide is a, listen, I'll give you the definition. It's a deliberate and purposeful dumbing down of a populace by false or twisted information. And when I say that, I'm not trying to say something or trying to throw a stone at somebody, because I honestly don't have a stone to throw at anybody, because I'm not sure. Well, I do. I will have one stone that I would throw, but I don't mean to hurt this guy. It would just be I would point a finger, and that would be Constantine. Just go back and study, and I'm not mad at Constantine. In many respects, I'm glad for him, or I'm sad for him, or whatever Constantine's purpose was, but Constantine successfully brought you and me in a state of blindness so that we have bought the religious lie that he began to unfold for all of us through the Nicene Creed and the Nicene Council. You will take the Nicene Creed, whether you have 12 paragraphs in your creed or the Apostolic Creed with 13, it doesn't matter to me, any one of them, they start out, we believe, we believe, we believe. And every one of you believe those things to some degree or another, consciously or unconsciously, and they are not validated in Scripture. But you think they are. You think that they are about the things in the Bible. But they're not. They're about the doctrines that men built. Theologies, different eschatology, different ideas and concepts that man built from the information to menticide you and me. Now, I don't know that you get it. I hope you do get it. And then another word that I used last night, I want to give it to you again. Mental scotuma. Mental scotuma. Mental scotuma means the absence of insight into or inability to comprehend. I have made it a purpose in my life. I've been a pastor for 37 years. And I don't have a clue where that time went. Because I don't think I'm much older than that. But somehow or another, the time has come and gone. And I'm still standing here hammering. And I remember when I went to my mother, and I had a dream. God came to me in a dream, and I had a dream. And I wasn't familiar with the Bible, really, that much. And I had this dream, and in this dream, I think it was Numbers 19 come to me. And just in the dream, I didn't even know if there were that many. Exodus 19 came to me. And here's what it said. And this was, I woke up, and I thought, wow, did I really have that dream? And I could quote this in that dream. And so I looked in the Bible, and it said this. It says, now, if you will, and I just put Lynn, if you will obey my voice, and if you'll keep my covenant, you will be a peculiar treasure unto me, and because the earth is mine, you'll be unto me a priest. I read that myself to say, you'll be a preacher, because I didn't know any different of a priest. That's right, preacher, priest, or whatever. Etc. And so that was a personal thing that I saw. So what I did, I went to my mother. And I said, Mama, I'm going to be a preacher. She kind of lied. She said, no, I got you out of jail too many times. Ain't no preachers in our family. Busted my bubble, you know, and I thought, wow, I thought my mama would bore anybody. Well, my mother then became one of my greatest supporters and one of the ones that said, I don't know where you get all this stuff. You get, but keep getting. I remember one time I sat with a family, a big family, so we have big family get-togethers. And I sat with my nieces and my nephews, and we were trying to talk to them about hell, and it was at a Christmas gathering, a family get-together, and I answered a question my mother asked. She was an instigator. I guess where I got that, I don't know. She asked the question. We were all sitting around in a room. There's 25 or 30 or more of us, nieces, brothers, sisters, etc., family. And she asked me a question about hell. I answered that question, and they created a discussion, a topic, you know, what about hell? So I asked that question. That started at 9 o'clock when we were getting ready to go. We needed to go and get home. This was on Saturday night. I had church Sunday morning. So when you're a preacher, everything centers around you. You got to be at church on Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. That's how life is when you're a preacher. It's around that. So we had to leave. Well, finally, at 1 o'clock, I finally said, I'm not answering no more questions. I'm leaving at 1 o'clock. Started at 9. Yeah, it did open up a lot of different cans of worms and ideas. But, you know, that's necessary. And I think it's just like this conference in these times where people begin to open up and share and come out of their own heart and add to. This is rich.
Yes.
This is transforming. And this is exactly what's happening. And this is where we are. So these two particular words, menticide, mental scotuma, where purposefully you and I have been dumbed down or we have been given wrong information. And I feel a passion about this. You probably can't tell that, but you can. I feel a passion about this because I really would like to stand on the rooftop. I really would like to get on in front of a TV camera and say to the world, we've been lied to, that the truth is for setting you free, that the Sabbath is so that you can find your freedom and find your peace. That's what God longs for you to experience more than anything, because as you do, He does.
Yes.
And everybody I know longs for those things. I don't care who you are or where you're at or what color of skin or anything at all about that. And so I also mentioned these two particular ologies. And soteriology is something that you are taught in seminary. It's not something that you study and extract it from Scripture. You're not going to go into Scripture and extract soteriology. They take a Greek word, they add ology on the end of it, and then they come up with an entire belief system that the church feeds you and me through menticide. They feed this information, and if I were to talk to any preachers or just about anybody about soteriology, you know what they're going to tell me? They're going to tell me that it is about salvation. That it's about them getting saved. But they don't even understand or don't know really what this is about, because it's not about salvation. You and I have this idea that salvation is something that we have to experience. We have to have that or we'll burn in hell. That is a fear tactic that the church has used against us to try to put us in a fear mode, to try to put us in a place where they can control us, where they can manipulate us, they can bring us to a place where we have to submit and succumb to what they say. That's really the root behind this concept of soteriology. And another one, this one is such a pet peeve of mine, because I see it in us. I see it in so much of humanity. And it is the concept of harmatiology, from the Hebrew, or from the Greek, harmatia. Harmatia is the word translated for sin. Actually, it is the word, and that's where the whole concept of sin come from. It's from this, in ancient Hebrew, you have two different words, chatah and chataath. Both of those words are translated sin, have almost the same meanings as the Greek harmatia and harmatana. Harmatia, this idea of sin, They define this word sin as you making a mistake, or you are. Here's one. Here's really one. How could we buy this? Here's one. Said, you're born that way. And we bought that.
Yep.
I did up until my grandkids started coming along. I wasn't even thinking about it when my own children were coming along, because I was a kid myself. So I wasn't thinking about that they were sinners, that they were sinful, and they were just born this way. They're just born corrupt. They're born wicked. Y'all thought that. Y'all actually believe that. Most people do believe that today. I don't know how in the world could we be that dumb. I mean, all you got to do is look at one and see how innocent, how pure, how beautiful that they are. Yeah, but Brother Lynn, when they get a year and a half old or two, they become little demons. They don't. They become little balls of energy that so, and there's something that's working in them that the church successfully dumbs down through mental scotoma or through menticide, and that is the psychological ability to take something and tear it apart and then put it in their little brain, put it and deposit it in their little being, and then it becomes a way of thought to them. And when you teach them that stuff, they begin to think that stuff. It's me pulling it out of them 30, 40, 50 years later trying to set them on the track that's straight.
Wow.
And what happened? We took them when they were pure and when they were innocent. We did it ignorantly. I'm not throwing a stone at anybody. I did it. I've gone my girls time and time and time again. I apologize. I'm sorry. I shouldn't have taught you that. I shouldn't have said that. I shouldn't have done that. I didn't know any different. But hallelujah, we are in a day. We are at a time when we're beginning to see consciousness is rising. Consciousness is beginning to arise within each one of us. And we're beginning to see that these lies we have been fed, these lies are not helping us, but they're hurting us. Now, I know that you guys can write this down and you can do some of the research on it if you like. And the Council of Nicaea, I don't have to say a whole lot about the Council of Nicaea. You already know about the Council of Nicaea. But if you haven't read much about it, just read it. 325, the Council of Nicaea. The Council of Constantine, 381. And here is another one, the Council of Carthage, which was 419. These councils were where the bishops were drawn together, the leadership of what we call the church, or what has become the church, so that they could find ways of combating these movements that they call Gnostics or Gnosis, where the Gnosis were based off of the same thing as Kabbalah. It was an intuitive thing. It was a thing they understood within their very being. So these councils were purposefully formed so that they could combat. The Council of Ephesus, 431, and then the Council of Chalcedon. The Council of Chalcedon, I urge you, please, look this one up on the internet. Read about it. Find out about it. 451, the Council of Chalcedon. That's when they sent their Jesuits, their monks, their priests all over the world as rampaging murderers. And the reason they would kill you was because you did not bow to the concept of the Jesus they had created. And it hadn't been created that long in their concept and their ideas. Just look it up. Read it. Inform yourself about this information. And if you do, and when you do, it's not a matter of an issue of me proving a literal Jesus or disproving a literal Jesus. That is not the issue. If there was a man that walked on the face of this earth and his name literally was Jesus and he did the very things that he did, he would not have any part in any church that I know of today. So I'm not throwing a stone at that. I'm not trying to disprove it. I'm trying to get you and me to see who I am.
Yes.
Why am I here? What was my purpose for being created? Yes. The council meeting formulated all the beliefs that we have been told as truth. And they said, these are the truth. They weren't the truth. They were the things that they had concocted. Even though they were established on lies and they were established on falsification, The council's aim was to take ancient philosophy, which was built on the wisdom in nature, and create fiction and create historical characters from it. And they hammered at this, and they hammered at this, and they hammered at this. They come together in huge meetings, and the purpose of that, you either come to this, you succumb to it, you believe it, you embrace it, and you take it back, or we will kill you. That's it. Bow or burn. And they, at the Council of Chalcedon 451, they decided that they would establish what they wanted to be truth. Anyone who disagreed, they were to be anathematized. In other words, kill them, period. And you can read the gory stories out that they would kill children. They would take babies from women's breasts that were nursing and kill them. All because they would not bow. They didn't even know. They didn't know Jesus. They didn't know they were supposed to do this. They already had their own systems. They already had their own wisdom material. What we fail to remember is we did not design ourselves. God did. The human body is not a chance of random evolution. It's not. It is a divine design.
Yes.
It's not a random chance of evolution, but it's special design. It's a building that's built and designed by God itself and built for special purposes. Gosh, if you could just hear that in your heart, if that could just ring inside your core of your being, and you could realize that you are special. Period. I don't care who you are, where you've been, and what you've done. You're special.
Amen.
People want to throw stones at other people simply because they don't fit their box, they don't fit their belief, they don't act like they act. Well, aren't we glad? Hallelujah. I like variety. I don't know about you, but I like variety. I like chocolate and vanilla. So, when we enter the earth dimension, we enter into Eden. You are not a mistake, or what religion calls sinful. You came here to the earth as a spiritual being in God's image, but you experience it as a human being, not flawed, not sinful, not evil, not bad, not wrong, not disobedient, but God. Spiritual being with a human animal body. When I say human animal, I'm just simply saying if you leave the spiritual equation out of your life, you will be very little different than an animal. You'll kill each other. You'll fight each other. You'll hurt each other. You'll act no different than an animal. Does an animal have a soul? Of course it does. Does a human have a soul? Of course they do. But can a human act like an animal? We do it constantly. Why are we constantly killing each other? We constantly killing each other in the name of our God, in the name of our religion. Now, do you think that's how God designed us to be right, them to be wrong? Come on. I mean, you know, surely the earth. And you know, one of the things that the whole Christian community and religion in itself is fussing and fighting about right now? The world is beginning to rise in consciousness simply because one of the biggest tools that we have is the internet, because of information, because they're getting the information, they're rising wisdom, and knowledge is increasing, but not in the church, because they're still locked back here in 325. We believe they're still locked in 12 creeds that don't mean come here from Sikkim when it comes to spiritual growth and spiritual matters. So their consciousness is raising, and the Christian community is just staying at a little or nil or nothing.
Stagnant.
Yeah. God, what'd you call that?
Stagnant.
Yeah. Amen. Stagnant. God did not design religion, man did. God, that's not God. That's not God's design. Religio comes from the religio. God did not design that. Man designed that. You were born a sinner. That's religion. That's not God's design. You were born a Baptist, a Methodist, a Hindu, a black, a white, etc., etc. You were born spiritual beings with a physical body. Period. That's who you are. Everything in your body at this moment and even now is connected to God. It doesn't matter who you are, again, or where you're at, or what you're doing, or whatever. It's still connected to God, and it is an aspect of God. It's a part of God as God begins to develop and show himself throughout the earth. Now, I want to, if you have a Bible, if you can find the book of Genesis.
Crazy.
Yes, John.
Just running through a phrase in my head of when God created us, separated himself from himself so that we came out of that. That initiated a practical process.
Yes.
The business of what you've just been talking about, and I'm using the incorrect term church, those who are in power and control, exemplified by the councils, are at the business of ending the practical process, not letting it continue.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
That's yeah, stagnating.
Stagnating,
yeah,
let it.
Yeah. And are they doing that in ignorance? I think so. I don't think that there's a purpose, design behind their thinking. Yeah, I think it's ignorance. And so, do I wink at it? I do. I love them. I embrace them. You say, I can go over here to First Baptist Church and go in there on Sunday morning and I can have a good time. I can enjoy and I can actually extract something out of it that's God. I guarantee you I can. I can go over there and sing just as I am and enjoy it. You know why? Because I'm free from any bondage that would be there or would try to be put upon me.
Amen.
I don't have to be condemning or putting down. And I know that what I say sometimes may sound or come across that way. I don't mean it to. I want us to come to a place of consciousness where we raise ourselves. We begin to realize that we are designed the way we're designed by special design. And there's nothing wrong with the design. I keep asking people, and I put this out on YouTube or wherever the CDs go, I would love for people to show me where man made a mistake in Genesis. Show it to me. Just point it out. I'll be glad to see it.
Brother Lynn, if we look at things like, we should have done that. This is what happened. This is where the evil came. This is what this and this and that happened. There was already planned for us to go through all of that. But now we're at the point where we are waking up to understand what we did wrong or what the evolution through which we have come had to go through that. To say that it didn't is like to say that a worm could not become a butterfly.
Mm-hmm.
You know, right. That had to happen. That darkness, that blackness in there had to be the way it was in order for it to develop the beautiful wings. And each one of us is supposed to be something like that.
Amen.
You know, so we can't say we should have or we could have or I'm sorry that it happened. No, it was supposed to be that way.
Yeah, there you go. Design. Nobody did anything wrong. Yes.
I'm trying to sort out the thing about were they ignorant or whatever, and the best I come up with at the moment when I think about that is the difference in that book of power and force of love. Man has to figure out that love liberates.
Amen.
And all that dogma stuff is force. It's rooted and based in wanting to control someone else.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And we can call it ignorance or whatever, but at the very root of it, is a lack of ability or wantingness to let everyone just be.
Mm. Yes. I think, in my opinion, I think greed's behind it.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's the greed
and
the need to control.
Mm-hmm.
That's how I feel because, and it could be monetarily driven, which I feel that too, that it is monetarily driven. But there's, again, it's purposeful menticide. It's, I mean, there's not any other way to look at it other than that's what's happened. Now, she made it, she used a word, and I've been trying my best not to use this word, because in the morning, I'm going to drop a bombshell on you about this particular word that's used, and I have been saying it for years myself, and that is waking up, that we need to wake up. And so I've been scratching my head when I've been saying that myself, but I've been saying that, and now I'm trying not to say that, because we... It will be something also that you just said. If I learn to embrace the darkness is not something that has lulled me to sleep. I have been told I was lulled to sleep. And since I'm asleep, I need to wake up. Well, I've been trying to figure out why or where am I asleep. Now, I know I went to sleep last night and slept a few hours in my physical body. But when I say I need to wake up, am I talking about physically waking up? Am I talking about mentally waking him up? Am I talking about spiritually waking up? And so I'm saying all this because I want you to think, because I really don't think your problem is waking up, even though I've been telling you that's your problem. And where do I get that idea? I get it right out of Genesis chapter 2. And I get it out of Genesis chapter 2, where I have read from the English King James where I have read that God put him to sleep and never woke him up. But I'm going to tell you in a little while, either I may not this evening, I may have to do it tomorrow in the morning, but I'm going to tell you that is not what the Hebrew said. God did not put anybody to sleep and do surgery. Think about it. It's like I will show you how that Salvin constantly, just like a Fibonacci or just like a fractal, repeats itself in the first 12 chapters of the book of Genesis for a purpose to set a pattern so that you can begin to realize 7 is always a number that refers to the perfect design of God, which is your physical body. Amen. 7 days or 7 yoms or 7 generations and our 7 sons is constantly a different way to say the same thing about you.
Yes.
Let me just show you that. You're familiar, aren't you? You're familiar with, y'all made me get off my notes. You're all familiar with Genesis.
I'm bad.
7 days, right? Huh? Y'all familiar with the Genesis 7 days?
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people aren't hearing and haven't heard the teaching I've been heralding for years about the 7 yoms. It's the Hebrew word for day. It's really the Hebrew word that means facets of life or inherent life or life by design. So when I see the 7 days, which is actually the 7 yoms of Hebrew, I'm seeing the 7 facets of design that built your physical body. Am I getting too loud? Am I waking y'all up?
No, sir. I didn't bother you. We're showing some people around there.
I don't need a microphone. I got it out there in the gym. The 7 yoms are the 7 facets of creation that causes you to live your body. 7 endocrine glands. The 7 major functions that grow an embryo in the womb of its mama. You know, the stick man, that's your stick man. That's what it's all about. That's what it's all about. And so, here, I will show you something. Look at Genesis chapter 2. Go with Genesis chapter 4. Let me show you something. Real quickly, I'll scan this for you. I'll just run through this. And there's, you know, this is a whole series. This is a book that I'm fixing to share with you in just a few minutes. Out of the first 12 chapters of Genesis, of things that I plan to write. I plan to expose this thing because it's here. It's just right here. And you have the eye to see it. And I'm telling you, you are awake enough to see it.
Yes.
Look at this. In Genesis chapter 4, verse 1, it says, And Adam knew his knew Eve. Everybody say Eve.
Eve.
And she conceived. Everybody say she conceived.
She conceived.
And bare Cain. Verse 2. And she again bare his brother. Let's everybody say she again bare.
She
gave birth to one then, didn't she? All right, then look over at Genesis chapter 5 and verse 3. It says, and Adam lived 130 years and begat his own likeness. Now he's bearing children. I know you have never seen that before. She starts to bear them, now he's starting to bear them. You see, if we would come back to the ancient understanding of the androgynous one and realize that I am male and female. And when he's talking about Adam and Eve, it's talking about me. When God's talking about taking something out of Adam to create Eve, he's talking about something taking, he's taking something out of me or adding something to me.
Yes.
We haven't seen that. We're still stuck in the story that we learned in Sunday school that was a lie. It was a intentional dumbing down. We think from that paradigm and don't realize we think from that paradigm, and it begins to build many of the things, structures in our life. Just exactly like original sin. That is a doctrinal issue that's created by the church at these councils to say that you have sinned. You are a sinner. You're no good. And we've got to get you saved. You see, if they can't get you lost, they can't get you saved. How in the hell are you going to get somebody saved if they don't even know they lost? I mean, that's a difficult task, I'm telling you. It's hard to do that. And if you can understand I've never been lost, and therefore the only salvation that I need is the wholeness and the health and the deliverance that's already in me, for me. So when Adam begins to bear, and you can, I'll just run through them real quick right here. He bore, Adam bore, and he begat Set, Enos, Cana, Mahaliel, Jared, Enoch, Methuselah, and Lamech. And if you were to look at that, I just named seven yawns. Seven facets of creation. And so now then, I'm taking Genesis chapter 1 and I'm repeating it again. And then from here, I come up with a character. Now this first set of yawns was out of the design, the divine design of God, which creates spirit. So first off, you're what?
Spirit. Spirit.
You're first off spirit. And then here comes Noah. And that's what his name means. And so when you follow the lineage of Noah and you look at the, and always you'll find behind these, if it's spirit, always behind Adam and Eve, you'll have three. Spirit, soul, and body. Cain, Abel, and Seth. Right?
Yep.
Then the next one you come to after the seven creations of Seth, which is spirit, that's what his name means, Seth. You have seven sons. These sons have phenomenal names, and you take the numeric values of these names and the days of their life, you try, well, this will be 900 and something year old. Bull! Shit. Come on. Now you see, we have believed this, making it literal. It's not literal. These numbers have tremendous value. They have to do with the things of God working in you. There is more work for me to do in Genesis 1 through chapter 12 than I can do in my next three incarnations. This is so chock full of truth. This is a Fibonacci sequence. This is fractal in its ancient wisdom to show us that God cannot fail. How can you embrace a God that has a failure of this thing he created that decided to rebel against him and create war against him? He said, now I've got to come up with another solution. I've got to have another plan. Well, what makes you think his second one ain't going to fail? Or his third one, if that's how it is. I'd like to get on the top of the roof and shout that.
Brother, could you
decipher 930 years of Adam for me?
Oh, goodness, I could, but all of these, if you take each one of them.
Well, just that.
And I have done so much work on these different ones with their Jared, Enoch, Methuselah, Lamech. It'd be a whole series of a book at all. You'll get that. So then we come to Noah, and I tried to do a little bit of foolishness about our concept of this big boat. You can't float a boat that big in 22 feet of water. I hope you can grasp that. Whether you put 2x2 on it or 7x7 on it. That is such a deep, profound story. The same identical word ark that Noah built the boat with is the same identical word for ark that Moses built. Same thing. It was the same ark. Do you not know who the ark of God is? You not know where that is hid at? It is your physical body. This is the one that's hid under the mercy seat of God. It's the physical body. This is the ark. This is where the treasure is at.
Yeah.
It's inside you. It's not something you've got to go out looking for. It's not something that you get outside your body. So then you go with the story of Noah. And right now the whole earth is under the shakings and deceptions of three of Noah's sons, which is what's going on in the Middle East right now, why they're killing each other. Over these three boys, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. And there again, these three boys aren't got nothing to do with nationalities of people over there fighting over who's got the rights to this or that or the other. But they've been fighting over it. You know why? Because they take a book that's based in spiritual typology, spiritual mythology, spiritual characters, and they try to make a history out of it, try to make it really legal, and then trying to figure out it's ours. We have the right for it. And we'll kill you to prove it. So they've been fighting Shem, Ham, and Japheth over it. And then when you come over to after these boys, they begin to do their thing. Come over to Genesis chapter 11. And you read here, then these are the generations of Shem. And then in verse 12 is Arphaxad. Verse 14 is Selah. In verse 16 is Eber. In verse 18 is Peleg. In verse 20 is Reuel. In verse 22 is Sarah. And verse 24 is Nahor. And verse 26 is Terah. And there again you have seven again boys whose names, if you do the research and the study on the names of these boys, again you're going to come up with the seven facets of life that live you. And from this one, from Terah, again you come up with three boys. And the character that's picked out of these three boys is Abram. Why? Because Abraham begins to represent Abraham and Sarah, the seat, the throne room of God, where God sits, which is your cerebrum, right here. Your ability to think, your ability to imagine, your ability to do the miraculous, to be the one you've never been, to go the place you've never gone. It's right here. And you know what? The church has not wanted you to think. It's not wanted you to go there. It doesn't even want you to even think you can go there. Right there. The story of Abram and Sarah, and the rest of them just begins to unfold. Because they represent the psychological, neurological aspect of your being where you can think, you can come up with you have the mind of Christ. Let this mind be you. It is you. It is who you are. It is who I am. And so I'm going to, I really wanted to read some stuff out of here. Time slips away, doesn't it? let's see here. I wanted you to... didn't even get my stick man on the board. in closing, I'll start there in closing. This is the power of 12, and this is the power of 7. That's Genesis to Revelation. That's the whole Bible. The whole Bible is about 7 and 12. It's about these numbers and about how these numbers work. It's how the astrological movement of the sun, the moon, and the planetary systems work together in union with, as we begin to synchronize ourselves with this vast movement of the power, of the essence of God, Son, etc., whatever name that you would like to give, because it's constantly moving, this energy is constantly moving, constantly creating, constantly, what was John's word, intercoursing itself, creating, it's just loving, that's another word, it's constantly dancing with itself. There's this constant movement. This is the kingdom of God. Look at the word number 12. 12 foundations in the house. 12 sons of Jacob. 12 apostles. Do you think that those are just accidental? Do you think that they're purposeful? Do you think 12 stones on the breastplate? No, these things are, again, fractal. They're constantly saying the same thing, but saying it a different way.
Yes.
And the reason I say it a different way is so that you and I can get the picture. We can begin to embrace this. We can begin to see it. And the 7 is over and over repeated. It's referring to the physical body, which is God's temple, which house you are.
Yes.
And so the ancient wisdom materials constantly talk about this, and so I wanted to close by reading this to you maybe. In the mythology of the solar god, who in his primary form was Ptah. This is the Egyptian Book of the Dead, or the subtitle of it is the Book of the Going Forth by Day. And I like the subtitle, Going Forth by Day, because basically that's what it is. In the morning, I will talk about him going to sleep and either waking up or not waking up, if that's really what happened. That's not what happened. That's tomorrow. Let me read this again. In the mythology of the solar god, who in his primary form was Ptah, or Kiefer, is the maker of a complete cycle, or circle, for the sun as the founder and opener of the nether earth. This solar pathway being a figure of forever, a type of the eternal working in time. Did you get that? Of the eternal God working in time. It's saying the timeless in time. It's saying the immaterial in material. It's saying spirit in matter. Again, how many ways can you say it? In the eschatology, the God and Spirit who is Ra, the Holy Spirit, is the God who has created or opened eternity. The one is on the physical basis, the other is on the spiritual plane. The one is on the physical basis, the other is on the spiritual basis. It's the marrying, it's the dance of the 12 and the 7. And all of the ancient mythologies, they knew this, they seen this. That's why this book was written. This book is written off that ancient wisdom. The Bible is based off this ancient material. It's not based on history of people doing certain things. I mean, you know, man, look at the story. Samson, he goes in there, pulls the temple down on him. I mean, he's strong. Have you ever really seen how big those columns are? Come on, he'd been eating Sweeties, he'd been eating spinach. You know, we believe these things. That guy take that job on that ass, go whoop 3,000 men. Oh, man. Hollywood really, really trumps on that stuff. Don't y'all enjoy that? Hollywood, they really. So, the mythology, the one of the physical basis, the other is the spiritual basis. In the mythology, the seven primordial powers that pass through the various phases, elemental, stellar, and lunar, always in a group of seven, finally become the seven souls of Ra, who attain supremacy as the sun god in mythology and also as the Holy Spirit. And he goes on and he says a lot more about that particular thing. And then I want to read you this. That's, again, the Egyptian Book of the Dead. This is the paraphrase by Dorel of the Emerald Tablet. Deep in the dark halls sit the seven units of consciousness. From cycles above, manifest they in this cycle as guides of men to the knowledge of the all. Seven are they, mighty in power, speaking these words through me to men, time after time, stood I before them, listening to words and came not that came not with sound. Listening to words that came not with sound. Have you ever heard them? Hear them. They're on your breath. Take the time to hear those words. They are on your breath. Say amen. I'm just going to just cut that off and stop right there. Do y'all, anybody would like to ask a question or make a comment or? No? Yes.
The other day I was listening to Dr. Dyer. He had this beautiful lady singing Amazing Grace. And I was just curious to see if they're going to put the word wretched in there that say a wretch like me. What they put was is who saved a soul like me.
Oh, they changed it.
Yeah. And I thought that was very, very beautiful.
Yeah. They changed it. That's good. I think we're changing a lot of songs, the words of the song.
Yes.
If I have just a short period of time, I'd like to cover the three Greek words that we use for awakening, because that has become a religious cliche, maybe in the morning, these three Greek words that we've all heard and we've talked about it, that there's a process between awakening and rising. And I think that we keep thinking we're at the awakening stage, and I want to show just in maybe a few
Greek
words.
In the morning you can take your time.
Yeah, so I got some of that. Well, you were speaking Friday night, and I started writing. I thought, what is this? Where's this coming from? And then you just...
Well, let's say this with me. Say, Tardama.
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 Yashin.
Yashin.
That's Hebrew, so you're learning Hebrew. Tardama Yashin. I will break that word down in Hebrew in the morning, and I will show you it hadn't got anything to do with anybody's sleep. It's very, very profound. Very profound. As a matter of fact, it will enhance your being as you begin to see what it's saying.
Yes.
It's right here. It's been in this book all this time. Always been here.
When I was looking at those words a few months ago, I started looking that up, and I was just blown away by how many times we use the term awakening, and I think that for most part, we are moved beyond that stage. We're in another
Well, way. I say it a lot. I'm not putting down any of us using that term. I use it a lot, but now I'm trying not to use it. Simply because of something that I have begun to see about this Hebrew word, Tardama Yashin. And so I realized that the whole idea behind I need to wake up, I use it and we've used it. But now I'm beginning to realize, wait, I'm awake. I'm awake. I was asleep last night. Sometimes you have dreams, sometimes you don't. But I was asleep.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Okay, I hope y'all didn't overdo it for lunch, because I'm not sure how many of you would, how many of you wanted to go over or will go over to the Western Sizzler with us? We go over there, they have a big room in the back, and you can go light if you want to just go over there and eat a light, a soup, and a salad. They have a really good fresh salad bar if you want to eat soup and salad. And so I thought it would be a good time for all of us that want to go to just go and eat and fellowship and talk, and we can ask questions, and you can, everybody can share and fellowship. Does that sound like a good idea?
Yeah, a little bit.
Oh, I just went around and holding yourself up there.
Oh. Yeah, back, hips, sitting in here.
Well,
I sit very long, and it's just stiffer and stiffer.
Okay.
And also, I fall asleep.